So during the initial months of 2020, air pollution levels across several parts of India especially went down on the back of COVID-19 as the world and the country came to a standstill. But once the restrictions were eased again, these air pollution levels spiked and we could see reports of rising air pollution levels across the country. Now, to understand this better, why some parts of the country have not been able to control the rising air pollution levels, we have with us Ms. Anumita Roy Chaudhary, who is the Executive Director of Research and Advocacy at Center of Science and Environment. Thank you so much, ma'am, for taking our time and speaking to me.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
Yes. I'd like to begin by asking, the government has time and again announced several measures, especially the central government and the government in Delhi also, right from the odd even policy to smoke towers now, but we still haven't been able to control the rising air pollution in the national capital. Where do you think are we failing, or are we not implementing these policies properly? Where exactly are we lacking to control it?
It's a very complex issue, actually.
Yeah.
So let's understand, because it is not so simplistic to say that pollution levels have not gone away because we have not done anything. Actually, the complexity is in the issue that we have done something, seen some improvement, but we have not done enough to see the cleaning up, the complete cleaning up, right? Now, from that perspective, it is important to understand first what has actually happened in the city, and then understand that what has not happened, as a result of which we are still facing this big challenge. So imagine a city like Delhi, if you compare it with other cities. So Delhi has already taken steps to shut down all its coal power plants.
Yes.
It has banned all old vehicles. There is a restriction on truck entry. BS6 emission standards in place. Entire public transport is running on CNG. Even natural gas usage has expanded for industrial use. And Delhi has notified the clean fuel policy so that dirty fuels don't enter the city and so forth, right? Now, having done all of this, and also including shifting big polluted industries out,
yes,
what we see is that on a year-on-year basis, the annual average levels in Delhi have started to come down.
Okay, right.
So at least what we are saying that Delhi has bent the pollution curve. But, and that is the big but here, that even after that reduction, and what our data showed of almost a quarter reduction in annual levels, Delhi still has to reduce pollution by yet another 60% to be able to meet the clean air standards.
Right.
But just imagine now, if after shutting down power plant, banning old vehicles, introducing new fuel, after doing all of that, and not small measures, right? You still are 60% off the mark.
Yes.
So imagine the scale and the speed of change that is needed today to further pull down the pollution levels. And therefore, let's understand now what has not happened in Delhi. And therefore, and where are the gaps?
Yes.
Now, some of the big gaps today, one is in the transportation sector. So even though we have improved the technology of the vehicle, gone to BS6 level, but because we are hugely deficient in public transport infrastructure, therefore the dependence on personal vehicles is growing and the volume of vehicles on the road is huge. And therefore to control vehicular pollution from that congestion, I mean, that's one very big challenge. So, and this is something that you cannot fix overnight for the winter, because the entire infrastructure of public transport will have to be scaled up. So that's one big problem. The second big problem is in the area of waste management. And we know that today it is the burning of waste or the dust from construction, and that's a huge source of pollution. That's because the municipal system that we require to collect and dispose of waste safely and reuse this waste, that is not at the level that is needed.
Yes.
So therefore the municipal, all our SDMC, NDM, and all of them will really have to scale up the waste management system across all neighborhoods, including unauthorized colonies, so that waste does not accumulate on public land, because then we are just going to burn it. So that's another big area where we have a huge problem. Right. And a third big area where we still have a problem is the large number of industrial units, many informal units in and around Delhi, where it's very difficult to control and inspect their emissions and also inspect the kind of fuel that they're burning.
Right.
So, and that's why you see, you know, the Mundka, Bhavana, Narela, you know, if you go to these areas, you will find that water industrial pollution is a huge issue. So therefore, that's how we now need to understand. So that going forward, one big challenge that we are facing, one, that we have not created enough infrastructure in these sectors. Second, this is capacity of the system to enforce is not strong enough.
Yes.
And all of these together are creating problem in the city of Delhi today. In addition to the other problems from outside, the, you know, the stubble burning, I mean, that's a separate issue.
Absolutely. Also, ma'am, I'd like to understand what are the measures that we are yet to take and what can be that to-do list that we can keep in mind to tackle air pollution? Because we are having this conversation at a time when we are fighting COVID-19, a virus that directly affects the respiratory system. And we honestly don't know how many more viruses and infections are we yet to encounter. So what are the steps that we're looking at?
So this is about winter, right? And because, and we are all worried about winter this year.
Yes.
So winter, we know every year is a bad season. That's the time when the reason why winter pollution is so bad is because during winter, the weather is very calm. There is no wind in the city to blow away the pollution. And as a result, the air gets trapped and whatever pollution is happening in the city also gets trapped, right? Yes. Now, therefore, if overall pollution levels are high in Delhi, then during winter, the trapping is also going to be high. Now, therefore, now, as I said, the fundamental solutions will come only when we take those big steps that I've just outlined, right? For the waste, for the public transport, for industry, and so forth. Now, during winter, all that we can do is to take emergency action. And emergency action means that what is it that you can do immediately to ensure that when there is fire, you don't add more fuel to the fire.
Yes.
Now, emergency action is not a magic bullet. Emergency action, which we take, is a more out of urgency and to ensure that when huge pollution peaks are building up, that we somehow try and taper off off that peak.
Yes.
You know, but we can't clean up the air because if there is no wind to take it away, pollution is not going anywhere. But what you can do is not to add more to it. Yes. So from that perspective, as you know, the graded response action plan has been put in place. And therefore this graded measure that they are planning today. So the minimum common measures have already been announced to be implemented during the winter. Right. And which means that they have banned diesel generator sets. They have, at this moment, they're asking for strict enforcement in all the sectors, right?
Right.
Now, in that kind of a scenario, when, even after doing all of this, when pollution levels are still going to increase during November, December, January, then we are going to take additional measures. And that's what we did last winter as well. When they shut down industry, they shut down construction, they stopped trucks. But this year is not going to be that easy. Shutting down is not going to be easy, keeping in mind that we are just coming out of a lockdown. Yes. And the lockdown, which has already destabilized and dislocated the economy and with huge livelihood cost. So it's not going to be easy to just shut down everything again, right? So this winter, therefore, we have to focus and try not shut down, but still be inventive enough to do good enforcement. And the good enforcement requires huge capacity. And I hope Delhi government and the NCR governments will focus on enforcement and focus on zero tolerance for violation. Right?
Right.
Now, so that's the way forward. And therefore, we can learn something from our experience during the lockdown. So for instance, normally during winter when pollution levels go up very high What we do, and when we try to control the vehicle numbers, normally the Delhi government does odd and even scheme, right? But this year, it will be better because now all of us have practiced work from home and we have collectively practiced that. So why not institutionalize that better during winter so that you can cut down on unnecessary travel and reduce the volume of traffic on the road, right? So like this year, we have to think more creatively so that we reduce pollution, we have good enforcement, we have strong deterrence in place, and for that, we have the right capacity. Because as you rightly said, that COVID is really going to complicate this winter.
Absolutely.
Because every winter we know, because of pollution, our respiratory system comes under huge pressure.
Yes.
Now, if your lungs are already weak, then you are even more vulnerable and susceptible to the COVID. The COVID is also a respiratory problem in a large way. So therefore, this year we have to be extremely cautious. And that's why I said this winter has to be about zero tolerance.
Absolutely. Also, ma'am, for the benefit of our viewers, could you please elaborate on how stubble burning affects air pollution, especially in the northern states in India?
Yeah. So let's first keep in mind that there are two kinds of pollution. One is a continuous pollution that happens all through the year, and they come from vehicle, industry, power plant, etc. And the other one is the episodic pollution, which is like stubble burning. And episodic, because this occur in episode. These are not continuous emissions. So this happens only when we are at the time of the harvest, right? So we know that every year, starting October and much into November, that is the period when farmers are changing crop and the maximum burning happens.
Yes.
And what we know, if you look at the science, that whatever data that is available from SAFAR and the satellite mapping done by other agencies, including NASA, they show very clearly that depending on the direction and the speed of the wind, that will determine how much smoke from the fields coming into Delhi.
Right.
And that can vary between 4% to 30%, right? So it's not uniform every day. But at the same time, we want to keep in mind that we want to discuss about the problem of stubble burning, not just because what it is doing to Delhi. We want to discuss about this because what it is doing to the larger northern India, and also even to the lungs of the farmers. So in any case, the stubble burning has to be controlled for everyone, not just for a few Delhiites sitting here.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
So now the question is, how do we do it? So, because when it happens, it does contribute quite hugely to the pollution in the region.
Yes.
And we need to control this. Now, what is interesting is that at least as of now, we have been able to identify that what the solutions are.
Yes.
Right? Now, and therefore, if you broadly classify them, there are the in-situ solution, the solutions that you practice in the field itself. So where you give subsidized machine to the farmers, and so that they can mix the straw with the soil and not burn it. And and so that it can also fertilize the field. So because if they burn, and the farmers should also understand that burning can also harm soil fertility. So it is in their own interest not to burn the straw. But the challenge is that both central government and the state governments, they have come up with a subsidy policy, and they are giving this subsidized machine to the farmers.
Right.
Now, but the challenge is that how do you ensure that the farmers, each and every farmer, get access to those machines on time and at affordable rates? And especially small and medium farmers. And you're talking about millions of farmers. Now, even though the process has started and the governments are working through the panchayats, they're getting the machines registered, they're creating rosters so that farmers can have access to the machine when they need. But still, what we need to do at a scale, that has not happened yet.
Yes.
So the systems to be put in place to reach to each and every farmer so that they don't burn, that is still not in place. And therefore, we really have to figure out how do we address that last mile, that how do we connect each and every farmer, right? And make it viable and affordable for everyone.
Yes.
So that's the big challenge and the bottleneck. The second solution, and which we are actually quite excited about, and it's good to see, at least even though it is nowhere near that scale that we need, but at least that process has started this winter. And this is where this straw can be used to produce something else. So it's very interesting that how power plants have been set up, and the power plants are actually sourcing agro waste to use it for power generation. Right. Even the industrial belt in NCR, if you go to Sonipat, Panipat, you know, Bhiwadi, Alwar, all the industrial areas there, they have started to switch to agro waste. They make pellets out of it. So we are finding new usage of that straw. IOC and the oil companies, they are now setting up plant to make bio-CNG from the straw.
Yeah.
Now the advantage of this action is that if this business model takes off, then you are adding economic value to that straw.
Yes.
So farmers can earn money by selling that straw.
Yes.
And if there is an economic incentive, then farmers will not burn. But for that, we need huge preparedness. At one level, all these business models have to be put in place. Companies need to come forward. And also we need infrastructure. Because the moment we have these companies using these agro-based residue, then you need a good collection system, you need transportation system, and that will require infrastructure. But if we can focus clearly right away on building that up, then in the coming winters, we'll certainly see an improvement.
Right. I'd also like to point out, ma'am, a lot of cities that earlier used to feature in the WHO's list of most polluted cities are no longer there in the list. So what are the lessons that we're looking at that we can draw from the measures that other cities adopted to control or tackle the air pollution problem?
So it kind of varies. We have to really look deep into other cities. But as I said, it's not really about a few cities being on the, you know, often the WHO list is more about a relative position rather than absolute position.
Yes.
Because in that particular year, if more cities turn up with higher level of pollution, then by default, the earlier ones go lower in the rank. You know what I mean?
Yes.
So that is really not a good measure to understand. It's more important to understand, and if you look at it nationally, then nationally, what we are worried about today, that almost 80% of the cities that we are monitoring currently in India, their pollution levels are now officially classified as critical pollution.
Yes.
And as you know, that under the National Clean Air Program, about 122 cities have been identified as non-attainment cities for violating the standards for clean air. And now they have a mandate to implement clean air action plans so that they can reduce their pollution levels by at least 20 to 30% by the year 2024, right? But lockdown has given us a very big lesson. The reason why we saw such lovely, beautiful blue sky during the lockdown is because pollution was cleaned up across the region, not just in few cities. So entire India had cleaned up.
Yes.
And therefore, even in Delhi or any other city, because that larger regional influence was removed, so Delhi and other cities also cleaned up. And that's a big lesson. We cannot keep our action confined only to a few cities because pollution does not follow administrative boundary. Pollution blows across region. And therefore, we need a regional strategy. And therefore, I just would like to draw your attention to this very scary report that came out only yesterday, that State of Global Air.
Yes.
And what it's showing us is absolutely stunning. First, India today ranks fourth in the world in terms of the death attributed to PM2.5. Okay. Not only that, since 2010, India has recorded the highest increase in deaths related to PM2.5 almost by 61%. Even ozone-related deaths have increased by 87%. But the most scary part of the data is that this time the State of Global Air has put out data for the first time on how infants get affected the newborn get affected by air pollution. And what it's showing that of the total infant deaths globally, 24% of that happens in India. Just imagine, the highest in the world. Yes. Now, that's the most scariest part. So it's not about just pollution levels going up and coming down in Delhi and few other cities. It's about Indian, 95% Indians not breathing air that meets the WHO guidelines. And that's why we have such huge health impact. And that has to be the target of action. So imagine a newborn baby dying within 27 days of the birth, right? Because the mother is exposed.
Yes.
Because of the exposure of the mother, the dirty toxic pollution is going to the fetus, right? And therefore the babies are they are being born preterm with lower birth weight and susceptible to host of diseases. So that's the challenge that we are facing today. So therefore what I would say when you're talking at the national level, that the national clean air program now of the government has to become a lot more stringent. It has to be now about legally binding targets. There has to be strong deterrence and compliance mechanism. It should be implemented just not within the city and the municipality boundary, but across the airshed, the entire Indo-Gangetic plain. You know, they have to adopt. So, you know, we keep blaming Delhi, but even what has happened in Delhi in terms of pollution control, how many cities in the Indo-Gangetic plain can say we have done that, even that, right? So even Delhi's action has not been replicated to the extent that should have happened, right?
Absolutely.
So therefore, we now really need that national blueprint.
Absolutely. As you correctly pointed out, ma'am, there are several reports that are coming in, keeping aside the State for Global Air report, there are several reports that come all throughout the year that explains how air pollution does not just target the infants, but almost every age group, and how it has its ill effects on almost every age group of people. I'd like to understand what are the measures that we're looking at as individuals to adopt in our lifestyles? Because as a citizen, when I look at these reports, they are scary. If I'm living, say, in the NCR, or if I have my relatives that are living there, I get scared. So what are the measures or the habits that we're looking at to adopt in our lifestyle?
Absolutely. You know, millions of personal decisions can really make a difference.
Absolutely.
Right? Now, first, let's look at what are those decisions that and choices that we can make purely at individual level first, right? So one, that when I'm going out, let me think, what is the distance of my travel? Can I walk? Can I cycle? Can I take public transport? Can I take Ola, Uber, and try and avoid taking out my car as much as possible?
Yes.
If I still have to take out my car, then can all family members combine their trips as much as possible so that you can reduce car trips per family, right? Walk as much as you can. Then if we all generate waste in household, do segregation, do household level composting so that the wet waste doesn't have to go to the municipality. But insist that your municipality collects your waste in a segregated manner, that the municipality sets up composting pits in your neighborhood so that all the dry leaves, etc., in your garden or otherwise can be composted, right? So that's one. When you're using electricity at your home, switch off light where you don't need to. Don't keep your television on a switch-on mode when you are not watching it. People don't understand that, you know, the sleep mode actually consumes more power than while watching television. Now, why we have to pay attention to electricity? Why do we have to minimize our usage of air conditioner? Because more you do that, you're reducing your requirement of electricity, and therefore you're reducing pressure on power plants, which are polluting.
Right.
So these are your individual solutions that you have to focus on. But at the same time, we are very aware citizen, so that you can play a strong community role. If there is a waste burning happening in your neighborhood, if construction happening without proper dust control measures, then you should be an aware citizen to push the community to take action. And finally, be understand the politics of the issue and make political demand for change. Because the big solutions are going to come from the hard decision.
Definitely.
And imagine all the soft, you know, we have done the cherry picking. All soft options are over. The future decisions will have to be hugely disruptive. But that requires public support. Because without public support, you will not get political response. So that's the way we as an individual really have to think and move forward.
Absolutely, ma'am. I think you made some really important points. And as we see it, the first thing, the basic thing that we need is that the air that we breathe is safe and it's healthy. And absolutely, ma'am. Thank you so much for speaking to me. And thank you so much for all your important points.
Thank you. Thank you very much.